So we never had a picture like this before Hubble. Nevertheless, he was able to calculate the distance to the galaxy in Andromeda and figure out that it's 1 million light year. Remember, our Milky Way is 100,000 light year, so it's 10 times the distance. Hubble said, my God, all these things that we called uninteresting, all these nebulas, there are other universes, there are other galaxies. We are not alone. There's not just one Milky Way. There's a whole slew of galaxies. So that's the second, that's the first discovery of Hubble, that all those nebula, that Messier catalog, which they said, don't look at them. They are not interesting. They are not comets. They are actually very interesting. They are actually other galaxies, just like our Milky Way. Hubble started the age of cosmology. Up until that time, we are just looking on our galaxy. Now we are looking at the cosmos. We are looking on the entire universe. We are looking at other galaxies. That is probably the most important discovery that Hubble made, that those nebulas are other galaxies. And he has done this measurement because he could look at one of these stars, Cepheid variable star, and he could use the calibration curve that Henrietta Leavitt gave him. Again, without Henrietta Leavitt, Hubble would be nobody. We would not even hear about it. And we should not forget how important is the work that Henrietta Leavitt did. So that's the first thing. Hubble could measure distances to galaxies. But he could do another thing. He could measure their velocity. Now, this should not be considered as math. If it is, then just fall asleep for a few minutes and I'll wake you up when we go to the next step. And this is called the Doppler effect. The Doppler effect is the following. If you have a source that is moving toward you and emits radiation, the radiation, the wavelength, gets packed toward the motion and get unpacked away from the motion. Okay? For example, a policeman in the old days would measure your speed, okay, with this radar, with a Doppler radar. By the way, they stopped using that because I told them that it's wrong to use it. That's another story. Okay, and now they're using laser. They're using laser. But they use a laser, not a laser, a Doppler gun that points the radar at you. You then reflect it. Because you're reflected and you're moving, you're reflecting it at a different wavelength. So they can measure your speed by measuring the wavelength that comes to you. So just to make you curious, the thing with the police went wrong is when they put the shine the light on you, a car moving toward the policeman will give the same signal as the car moving away. So if they are shining the radar on a divided highway, and there is a guy on the other lane moving away from the policeman, and that's the guy who is speeding, that guy is gone. By the time this policeman says, oh, somebody is speeding, he sees a car coming toward him, says, that must be the car that was speeding. But the signal comes from the other car. Okay? Because what the policeman can only see is a difference in the wavelength. Whether it's shortened or whether it comes longer, it doesn't matter. So that's why they stopped using it. Because on a divided highway, you cannot tell which car is the one which is speeding. The one coming toward you or the one going away from you. Of course, the policeman is going to be only focused on the car coming toward him. The car that went away from him is long gone by the time his brain starts working. Okay? So this is the Doppler effect. The Doppler effect is the same effect we use in the Doppler a radar that shows us the weather. Because what do we see? We see the motion of the droplet. So everything that moves around changes the frequency. So Hubble could look at the light coming from the star. So here is red, yellow, green, blue, violet. The light is coming from anywhere. Anybody who is shining, put light. If you put atom in the way, the atom absorbs certain light, and you see where the atoms are, you absorb and you have dark lines. Now, if these atoms are moving, they will absorb at a different frequency. Okay? That's the Doppler effect. And Hubble saw that all the atoms are moving toward the redshift. They are all over here. Everybody is moving away from us. Okay? That's known as the redshift. This will be this redshift. So if this is the wavelength of the light which is emitted, this is the wavelength of the light which we observe, and it's redshifted, it's larger, Z will come back to haunt us. Okay? So this redshift allow Hubble to measure the speed of the galaxies. And he found that all the galaxies are moving away from us. And he found another thing. He found Hubble's law. He knew how to measure the distances. You see, here is parsec. That's what he used. But we will use light year. So, for example, this is 1 million light year. Okay? And he measured the velocity. And he saw that the guys who are close to us are moving with a certain velocity, and the galaxies which are further away from us are moving faster. Okay? Everybody is moving away from us. The one further out move with a larger velocity. And there came this model that I would like to show you right now. I'll blow this balloon. Okay, now look at this balloon. As I blow it, all the galaxies are moving away from each other. If we are in these galaxies, all the galaxies are moving away from us. If we are on this galaxy, all the galaxies are moving away from us. Okay? So this balloon was first blown by a guy called the Tilde, and we call it the Tilde balloon. The Tilde balloon is yes? We are moving too. Exactly, because look, as I blow up the balloon, we are moving. But what counts is the relative motion between us and the other. We cannot tell that we are moving. Right now, when you and I are talking, we are spinning around the earth. Can we tell it? No way. Okay? We are moving, but we cannot tell. We can always look on relative motion. So you can see when I blow up this balloon, imagine I'll blow up this balloon like the entire room. We are all going to move. But all the galaxies are moving away from each other. Okay? Because we are all on this inflated balloon. That was the Tilde model. That turned out to be wrong. Okay? But it's a good model. This model assumed that we are living in a curved universe. That we are living on the surface of a balloon. A better model is baking bread and putting raisins in the bread. As the bread rises, all the raisins are moving away from each other. Okay? So that's the correct model that we have today. That the Tilde balloon doesn't work. But it's still good, because let's now, instead of inflating it, let's deflate it. All the galaxies come together. At some point, we were all just this one little dot in the earth. That is exactly right. That the Tilde, what's your name, kiddo?
Ben.
Ben, how did you hear about the Big Crunch?
I read it in a book.
You read it in a book? You mean you read books, you're not on the internet? Wow. Let's give him a big hand. Exactly. So we call it the Big Bang, before which there is no before, and the Big Crunch, after which there is no after. Very cute, but wrong. The Tilde model is wrong. The universe is not curved. We only have a Big Bang, and we are going to go forever, expanding. There won't be a big crunch. You know, it's a good idea, but it didn't work. So that's the Sita model. But yes?
Doesn't that depend on the amount of black matter that we...
Right, so we already know how to do that, and we went through the whole rigmarole, and we found out that the universe is flat. The universe is not curved. If you want, you and I can talk about this later, how we did it. But we know precisely how. Well, very recently, it's called WMAP, the Wilkinson Microwave Anisotropy approach. But this is a good example, because you can see how the Big Bang theory would come, okay? When everything was together, that's when the Big Bang, it all started at a certain time. Well, I said no math. This is no math. What happened? Why was Hubble not accepted? Remember, Hubble put his theory together in 1936 in the Silliman lectures here at Yale. Okay? But it's only till 1965 that we actually believed in Hubble. What happened in the intervening 30 years? When you take this balloon and you deflate it, okay, you go back to the Big Bang. I do this here with algebra, okay? And I can calculate how long it will take me to deflate this balloon and go back to the Big Bang. And according to Hubble, it's 2 billion years. Whoop, that was the problem. Already in the 20s, we knew that the Earth is 4.6 billion years old. The solar system is 4.6 billion years old. The sun will die in 5.4 billion years. Hurry up, guys, okay? In 5.4 years, the sun will die. Sun will live for 10 billion years. We spend 4.6... What, sorry?
The Earth is not older than the universe.
Exactly. So what will happen over here, you're good. What happened over here is the following. If I run this experiment, and this deflating the balloon back to the Big Bang, and what I'm doing it over here, I'm doing it in math. Okay, I'm thinking the inverse of the Hubble space. So I'm doing this crunching, but I'm doing it using math. I figure that the age of the universe is 2 billion years. But the Earth is 4.6 billion years. How could the Earth be older than the universe? You know, how can you be older than your parents? You know, I've seen a lot, but I haven't seen that yet, okay? So, people didn't believe in Hubble for a long time. Well, we know today that the calibration was off, and in fact, the age of the universe is about 14, to be precise, 13.8 billion years. So, that was resolved. But for a long time, it wasn't, and nobody believed in Hubble. Why do we believe in it? Here is another beautiful story. Out in Bell Lab in New Jersey, scientists/engineers were developing an antenna for microwave communication. Okay? They just wanted to be able to do, it's a very directional communication, it's a very efficient way to communicate. Microwave communication is very good. And they developed this antenna. And they were pointing the antenna toward the sky. Anywhere they were pointing, they heard a hum. They heard a signal. First thing that came, oh, New Jersey, New York City, those damn guys in Brooklyn, they make so much noise. Pointed away from New York. Pointed all the way straight up. Still, they heard the signal. Then this is, the damn pigeons. They killed all the pigeons. The noise, the hum, stayed there. Mr. Penzias went to John Hopkins University, and he gave this peculiar talk about this extra temperature. Extra temperature, what do I mean by extra temperature? You know when you warm up your water in the morning to make your tea, there's radiation that's coming from it, you can feel it. So radiation is associated with temperature. The higher the temperature, the more the radiation. So when you look up to the skies, there's radiation from a source which actually happens to be 2.7 degrees Kelvin.